Hey, Grace Bible Church family. I'm glad you are able to join us for worship today. I trust that you are all doing well during these days, trusting the Lord. We certainly miss having all of you in the church sanctuary together, but it's great to be able to worship the Lord online, at home. And so let me start our worship service with prayer. Father, we do thank you for this day. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And Father, thank you for technology, that we're able to have our worship service online, even though we would certainly love to be together as brothers and sisters in Christ. But Father, I pray that you would speak through our worship service today. Father, we know that there are some who are fearful, some who are lonely, some who anxious about the future, different things going on in our lives. Father, speak to each one, I pray, and certainly we would pray for a swift end to the coronavirus and the situation that's going on in our society today. And so we commit our worship service now to you. Father, we pray that you would be glorified in all that is said, all that is done. We give you the praise now in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a couple of housekeeping announcements. First of all, I want to thank you for your continuing faithful giving to the ministries of Grace Bible Church. Some of you have stopped by. Some of you have mailed in your tithes and offerings. Others of you have started now going online, which is great. I encourage you to do this. You can still come to the office. The office is open 9 to 5 each weekday. So you can come in person or mail it to the church, 222 Boulder Road, Gallup, New Mexico, 87301. Or you can go to our webpage, gracebiblegallup.org, and click on the giving tab that is on the homepage. But again, just thank you for your faithful giving to the work here. So I have some good news, and that is that Easter is not canceled. Yes, it is true. We will not be meeting here in the sanctuary as a body of Christ, but we will be worshiping at home, online. No one can cancel Easter. Jesus is risen. He is risen from the dead. And so get ready for next week, because I will be saying probably several times, "He is risen." And your response will be, "He is risen indeed." And so, we serve a resurrected Lord Jesus every day. We don't have to wait for Easter Sunday to worship the Lord. He is alive, and he holds the present and the future, and we trust him. So we're looking forward to having our Easter worship service. Some of you got the email about the fact that we will be observing the Lord's table or communion next Sunday, Easter Sunday, during the service, and some of you may wonder, well, how am I going to do that at home? Well, basically, all you need is some bread, maybe a tortilla. I assume you don't have any matzah in your house, but some bread, a tortilla, something like that, and then some juice. You may not have grape juice. Maybe you have cranberry juice, cherry juice, or just apple juice, or whatever kind of liquid. I'm not suggesting that you run out to the store just for the sake of buying grape juice. But have that ready next Sunday morning or whenever you watch the service next weekend, and we will have our communion service. I think that will be a great time for the body of Christ. Pastor Steve?
Hello, church body. We miss you guys again. To the youth, we miss you guys. I miss you very much. Don't forget, Sunday, we're going to have a Zoom scavenger hunt. It's going to be a blast. If you need the link, hit me up on Instagram or Facebook. But church, I want to share something that God has put on my heart. If you have your Bibles, write this down. Open up your word to Psalm 62, verse 8. And it seems like we can get inundated with negative news, stuff from our governor, KRQE, whatever it is. But, you know, our God has put joy and truth in his word. And let's read and hope in these things. Psalm 62, 8 tells us, "Trust in him at all times. O people, pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us. let's trust in these things. And something I wrote down, it's kind of a prayer before we get into worship. And let me lead you in this. God, you have come into my Egypt, and by hand you led me out. You have ripped apart the sea and walked me through the deepest parts on dry ground. You are leading me through the desert, and my soul desires the manna that you give, only you. I trust the promised land, the future, the hope of tomorrow. My soul delights in you and your promises. I will not be torn down. I will not be led astray. I will not let the liar steal my joy, for you are my strength and my stronghold. Church, let me encourage you guys, as we worship, let's push everything aside. Let's take all of our fear and cast it out. Let's hope in God's promises at this time. Let us be the difference, the salt in the world, the difference, because Christ is our Savior. Let's worship.
Fountain, dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy. As deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Holy Spirit, come.
Cries out to deep, as deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Everything. Now I gladly own Him as my King. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing blood? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in the grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin, and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Good morning, Grace Bible Church. Thank you, Pastor John, Pastor Steve, and our praise team. And Pastor John, thank you for reminding us that next week is Easter, and it is not canceled because Jesus is risen. And that is a perfect segue into today's lesson. And as you can see from my poster, there are three main compartments: stay rooted, stay plugged in, stay connected. And as you can see from the poster, Jesus is at the center. And because our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is risen, we surely have ways to stay rooted, stay plugged in, and stay connected to Him. Our first scripture is going to come from Colossians 2, verses 6 and 7. Colossians 2, verses 6 and 7. And it reads, "As you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving." Okay, my littles, you know we do visuals. Here is our tree. The Bible is telling us, like a tree has roots to stay standing, so do we need to stay rooted and grounded in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And you see, this is my little rendition of a branch falling away. Well, when the branch falls off, it is no longer connected to the tree or the fruit. So like this branch, we do not want to fall off. We want to stay connected. Another scripture that helps us understand that is John chapter 15, verse 5. John chapter 15, verse 5. And John chapter 15, verse 5 says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing." I have to read that again. "I am the vine, you littles are the branches." Remember, it doesn't matter how young you are still connected to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. "He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing." So the scripture says, without being connected to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, you can do nothing. Like the fruit on this tree, when we stay connected, we can do great things no matter how young or old we are. Okay, so that is how we stay rooted. Now, how do we stay connected? Now, I drew these little people, all different colors, because, you know, it doesn't matter where you're from, what house you live in, what tribe you're in, what you look like. We are all connected as believers in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I know you're wondering, well, why did she draw her little stick figures holding hands? Because we can stay connected holding hands as believers in the Word, listening to service like today via YouTube. So there are still ways for us to stay connected, even though we may not be together physically. And a scripture that's going to help us understand that is Romans chapter 12, verse 5. Romans chapter 12, verse 5. I'll give you a moment to get that. I'm going to start at chapter 4. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, so we, being many, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. That's how we stay connected. We are connected as members of the body of Christ. Our next scripture is 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 17. I'm going to change that to 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 to 18, because I want you to get a full understanding, because I know you have those scholar brains on. And it reads, "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you." Isn't that a beautiful scripture? And now, do you see this plug on the wall? This is my rendition of a plug. How do we stay plugged in? Well, I'm going to show you. Now, if your tablet or cell phone has a charger on it, but if it is not plugged in, it won't get any charge. You will not be able to use it. It is the same way with us. If we are not plugged into the Word, into prayer, into praising, then we're going to become dead in Christ like our phones. We'll lose our praise, our joy, and our faith. So I want you to look, stay plugged in to Jesus. And I'm going to read the scripture that goes with that. Oh, no, those were the scriptures. Forgive me. I thought I had another one. So as we focus on Romans chapter 12, verse 5, and 1 Thessalonians 5, 17. Did I read 1 Thessalonians 5, 17? I think that was a lot. Okay. Then we are to stay connected and stay plugged in through prayer, through praise, through reading of our word, through encouraging each other. We're not too young and we're not too old. So I encourage you, while you are home, while you are with your family, while you are with your siblings, while you're with your loved ones, remember, keep Jesus at the center, stay rooted, stay plugged in, and stay connected. And we look forward to worshiping with you in person soon.
Well, thanks so much, Megan. That was a great message for the littles and the bigs, for the children and for the adults as well, to stay connected to Jesus. You know, we serve a risen Savior, do we not? We're celebrating Easter today. We celebrate Easter tomorrow. We celebrate Easter next Sunday. We celebrate 365 days a year. And next Easter, although the sanctuary will be empty, well, so is the tomb of Jesus. So let's keep that in mind as well. I want you to turn to Isaiah chapter 52. We are still going to be looking at the wonderful names of Jesus, but we're moving on now from Isaiah 9 to Isaiah 52, 13 to 53, 12. Isaiah 52, 13 and following, it says, "Behold, my servant will prosper. He will be high and lifted up and greatly exalted. Just as many were astonished at you, my people, so his appearance was marred more than any man, his form more than the sons of men. Thus he will sprinkle many nations. Kings will shut their mouths on account of him. For what had not been told them, they will see, and what they had not heard, they will understand. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of parched ground. He has no stately form or majesty that we should look upon him, nor appearance that we should be attracted to him. He was despised, verse 3, and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely our griefs he himself bore, our sorrows he carried. Yet we ourselves esteemed him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging or by his stripes we are healed. All of us like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, but the Lord has caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. He was oppressed, verse 7, and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to slaughter, like a sheep that is silent before its shearers, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. As for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people, to whom the stroke was due. His grave was assigned with wicked men, yet he was with a rich man in his death, because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. But the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. If he would render himself as a guilt offering, he will see his offspring, he will prolong his days, and the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great. He will divide the booty with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death, he was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he himself bore the sin of many and interceded for the transgressors. Let's pray. Father, what a wonderful Savior is ours, Jesus Christ. Yes, risen from the dead, coming back soon. Father, we celebrate Resurrection Sunday every day of our lives as believers in Christ. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful name today, Man of Sorrows. As we approach Good Friday, this Friday, and Easter Sunday, Father, may we be reminded of this name. And Father, I wonder if Jesus is sorrowing and grieving over the many illnesses with the COVID and the deaths even in our country and around the world. Father, I pray for hospital workers, Lord, those on the front lines, for first responders, for truck drivers, for those who are working at various essential stores and are in contact with the public. Lord, would you keep them safe from the virus? Would you encourage them, Lord? Would you cast out fear from their hearts and their minds? Father, we pray for patients around our country, yes, around the world, who are infected. Father, bring them to good health, we pray. And Lord, again, I just want to pray for the swift end of all that is transpiring in our society. Certainly, Father, we are reminded we are not to panic. We have nothing to fear as believers in Christ, but we are to be prudent. Help us to do that. And so we commit our moments in your word to you. We ask, Father, that you would speak to everyone that is listening. And we give you all the praise and the glory and the honor, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, as the Lord prepares us for Easter, which is just a week, we have been taking a look at the amazing names of Jesus as prophesied in Isaiah 9, verse 6 by the prophet Isaiah, over 700 years before the birth of Christ. And just a reminder that these are the names of the one who died in our place, praise the Lord, to pay for our sins and then rose from the dead on the third day. This is typically what is known as Palm Sunday, the Sunday before Easter. So today on this Palm Sunday weekend of 2020, We'll look at another wonderful name of our Savior. It's found in the passage we read in Isaiah 53, verse 3. It says, He was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. So we're going to look today at a man of sorrows. I would encourage you sometime, either today or this coming week, to find the words, either in a hymnal or online, of the great song, the words and music by Philip Bliss, Hallelujah, What a Savior. Many of you are familiar with this song. It starts off, Man of sorrows, what a name, for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Guilty, vile, and helpless we, spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement, can it be? Hallelujah, what a Savior. Lifted up was he to die, it is finished was his cry. Now in heaven exalted high. Hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes, our glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring, then anew this song we'll sing. Hallelujah, what a Savior. And what a wonderful Savior Jesus is. The word sorrows in Isaiah 53:3 literally means pains, physical pains and mental pains as well, meaning anguish. Both the King James Version and the New American Standard translate this phrase as man of sorrows. As I read, the New International Version translates it man of suffering. You may have slightly different wording, whatever translation you're using as you watch our service today, but whatever translation it is that you use, the idea certainly is the same, that Jesus suffered greatly. He had great physical and mental pain and anguish and had plenty of sorrows. If you look at Isaiah 53:3, it says not only a man of sorrows, but it says he was acquainted with grief. He knew grief full well. You remember in John 11, 33 through 36, John 11, 33 through 36, we read, When Jesus therefore saw her, that is Mary, weeping because her brother had died, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and was troubled and said, Where have you laid him? This is the death of Lazarus. They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. So the Jews were saying, See how he loved him. He wept. He was acquainted with grief. And he also wept over the city of Jerusalem. You may recall this passage in Luke chapter 19, verses 41 to 44. This is a passage talking about Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem and the palm leaves being put on the ground, hence Palm Sunday. And Luke 19, 41 to 44 says, When Jesus approached Jerusalem, he saw the city, and note this, he wept over it, saying, If you had known in this day, even you, the things which make for peace, but now they have been hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will throw up a barricade against you and surround you and hem you in on every side. They will level you to the ground, your children within you, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another because you did not recognize the time of your visitation. In other words, they did not recognize the Messiah, Jesus Christ. It's interesting that the word wept used in Luke 19 when he wept over Jerusalem is a different Greek word from the word wept in John 11:35. The word in John 11:35 is the word dakruo, which basically means to shed tears. These are tears that well up in your eyes and then eventually flow down your cheek. But the word for wept in Luke 19 when he wept over Jerusalem is klio, which is an audible weeping with visible emotion. This weeping is the kind of weeping when we just lose control and begin weeping out loud. This is the kind of weeping Jesus did when he approached Jerusalem and thought about sinners who rejected him. Well, why did he do this? Because he, God in the flesh, loves sinners like you and me. Jeremiah 31:3 says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Romans 5:8, God demonstrated his what? His love in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Despite our sin, he loves us. You know, even though Jesus is called the man of sorrows, we are certainly not to think of Jesus as a mournful, as a morose individual. Being fully man, and of course fully God as well, but being fully man, we can be sure that Jesus had plenty of moments of great fellowship and laughter, certainly in his growing up years, as well as an adult. Children were drawn to Jesus. You remember the disciples, they weren't real thrilled at that at first. And Jesus at that time said, suffer the little children, or permit the little children to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. Children were drawn to him. Adults were drawn to him, his person, his teaching, his authority. Now listen, children and adults are not usually drawn to folks who are always mournful and morose. People who are dragging themselves around, always looking like they've lost their best friend, people are not drawn to that. So we are not to think of Jesus necessarily as a mournful person. Indeed, Jesus could, and in fact did, rejoice in his sufferings and his sorrow as he looked forward to what the outcome of his death and resurrection would be. That is the salvation of sinners, people going to heaven. In Hebrews 12 and verse 2, Hebrews 12 and verse 2, it says, we are to fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter or finisher of faith, who, now listen to this, for the joy set before him, endured the cross. So even though he was a man of sorrows, the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Well, we want to think a minute about the suffering that Jesus did endure, because we're looking at this man of sorrows, and we need to remember this as we're approaching Good Friday and, praise God, Easter as well. But our Savior, the man of sorrows, suffered greatly in several different ways, and I think you can probably think of these ways, but let me suggest them to you. First of all, Jesus suffered by leaving the glories of heaven. Can you imagine what heaven was like before there was anything else, and when the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, were having fellowship together from eternity past? How wonderful, how majestic, how glorious that must have been. It's certainly hard for us to get our minds wrapped around. But for Jesus to have to leave that for a time and come to this dirty, sinful, wicked world, well, we can just imagine that this had to cause him to suffer, to grieve. And then Jesus, of course, suffered as a man, as the God-man, fully God, fully man. He suffered all the things that we do, and then some, I think, the pains of childhood. And we know that he got tired. He was hungry. He was thirsty. He was tempted in a huge way by the devil. He was mocked. He was spit upon. He was beaten. And he was crucified, the cruelest form of execution that's ever been invented by mankind. And this is why Hebrews 2 and verse 17, Hebrews 2 and verse 17 says, therefore, Jesus had to be made like his brethren. He had to experience all the things that we do, all the suffering that we experience, and all the other things we experience. He says, in all things, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high thing, priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For since he himself was tempted in that which he has suffered, he is able to come to the aid of those who are tempted. Are you lonely today? Jesus was lonely. Jesus was tempted in all the ways, all the needs that we have. Jesus was tempted, yet without sin, the scripture says. In Hebrews 4, verses 14 through 16, I think you're probably familiar with these verses. It says, therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us draw near with confidence to the throne of grace. Oh, what a great verse for the days in which we live, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Jesus suffered as a man, and one of the reasons he did that so that he could understand the sufferings that we go through. My guess is that most of us, if not all of us, will not in our lifetime suffer all the ways that Jesus suffered. And then thirdly, Jesus suffered the wrath of God as our sin bearer. Remember, he came to this earth specifically to go to that cross to pay for the sins of people like you and me. The sins of people like you and me. God loved us so much that he sent Jesus Christ, his son, to die on the cross to pay for our sins. It says, he who knew no sin, the Bible says, became sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Jesus suffered greatly as he bore God's wrath in our place. I invite you to look again at today's passage. Look at all the places that indicate how much Jesus suffered. In verse 14, his appearance was marred more than any man, his form marred more than the sons of man. In chapter 53, look at verse 3, he was despised, forsaken of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, like one from whom men hide their face. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Look at him suffering in verse 4. Surely our griefs he himself bore, our sorrows he carried. We esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and affliction. Verse 5 of chapter 53, he was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. At the end of verse 5, by his scourging, by his stripes, the whippings he took, we are healed. Verse 7, he was oppressed, he was afflicted, like a lamb that is led to slaughter. Verse 8, by oppression and judgment he was taken away. Verse 8 again, he was cut off out of the land of the living. Verse 9, his grave, he died, was assigned with wicked men. Verse 10, but the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. All the suffering that our Savior did in our behalf. As a result, verse 11, of the anguish of his soul, it says in verse 11, he will bear their iniquities, end of verse 11. And then in verse 12, he poured out himself to death. He was numbered with the transgressors. He bore the sin of many and interceded for the transgressors. He did all of this so that you and I could have our sins forgiven and a place reserved for us in heaven as we put our faith and trust in him. Have you done this? Have you put your faith alone in Jesus Christ alone? Have you said, yes, I believe that Jesus is the perfect Son of God. He's the only way to get to heaven. By his own statement, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man comes to the Father but through me. And I believe that he's the only way to get to heaven, and I believe he died on the cross to pay for all my sins. I'm trusting him for that free gift of eternal life. I believe he died in my place, rose from the dead. Have you done this today? If not, I urge you, I beg you, as Paul said, be reconciled to God. Before this day is out, fall on your knees, repent of your sins, trust Jesus as your Savior. Well, Jesus certainly was the man of sorrows, but the question now needs to be asked, is he in 2020, on the verge of Easter of 2020, is he the man of sorrows now? Some of you may say, well, no, of course not, because he's risen from the grave and he's at the right hand of his Father in heaven. Well, hear me out. It is true that the man of sorrows is no longer suffering any physical pain. It is true he is in heaven now, seated at the right hand of God the Father. He is, according to the scripture, interceding for us in Romans 8 and verse 34. Romans 8, 34. Who is the one who condemns? The Apostle Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, says, Christ Jesus is he who died, yes, rather, he who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who, here it is, also intercedes for us. Back to Hebrews chapter 7, Hebrews 7 and verse 25. Hebrews 7 and verse 25. Therefore, he, that is Jesus, is able also to save forever, praise God for that, those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. I'm sure we don't totally understand what that means, but Jesus is interceding for us before God the Father. And then in 1 John 2, verses 1 and 2, 1 John 2, 1 and 2. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. If anyone sins, we have an advocate, we have a lawyer, as it were, with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he himself is the propitiation for our sins, not for ours only, but also for those of the whole world, that is, those who put their faith and trust in him. So yes, he is in the glories of heaven at the right hand of the throne of God the Father, interceding for us. That is a blessed truth for us believers in Christ. Having said that, I believe that Jesus is still grieving. I believe he is still a man of sorrows because he is weeping over sinners all over the world, maybe you, who will spend eternity in hell because they will not put their faith in Jesus Christ. Is he weeping? Is he sorrowing over you because you have not trusted in Jesus? Rather, you have or are trusting in the good works that you do to get you to heaven? Is he weeping over you because you are trusting who you may be related to? Or you're trusting in your baptism? Or you're trusting in the church that you go to? Or you're trusting in the religious rituals that you may do, but you haven't put your faith in him? If that is your case, then Jesus is weeping over you today because he knows your eternal destiny. But that can change if you repent of your sins and put your faith alone in Jesus Christ alone. But let me talk to all of you who are sisters and brothers in Christ, wherever you may be, all across the country watching this worship service. Let me address you. I believe that Jesus, the man of sorrows, the coming king, is also weeping over us believers today as well. You know, he loves us so much, and he wants the best for us. Jesus said in John 10:10, I have come to give you life and to give it to you, what? Abundantly. That's right. To give it to you abundantly. Yet, I believe that Jesus sees our sins and he weeps. He sees all of us not making godly choices in our lives. He sees us not, even as Megan mentioned, not remaining plugged into him by prayer and by worship, by talking to him, by thinking about him, not praying very much. He sees us not sharing our faith in Christ very much, and he weeps. Now, perhaps these descriptions don't describe you, but it does describe many believers today. Jesus knows the ramifications of these things in our lives. You see, sisters and brothers in Christ, Jesus wants better for us. Jeremiah 29 and verse 11. You know this verse, Jeremiah 29 and verse 11. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope. Listen, he does not want us to make wrong, unbiblical, sinful choices. He wants us to have hope, especially in the midst of this coronavirus situation. He does not want us to fear. Fear is not from him. Is there something in your life? I have to ask myself that as well. Is there something in my life that is causing Jesus to weep? Hear me. Jesus died for those things. I encourage you, encourage myself, to bring those things before him, to confess those things, to repent of it. Is it a possibility, and I think the answer is yes, that God is using this whole coronavirus situation, at least in part, to get believers in Jesus to get on their knees and repent of their sins? I would encourage you again before this day is out, brothers and sisters, to get on your knees before the Lord and repent of whatever sins you need to repent of before the Lord. Well, sisters and brothers in Christ, another week is upon us. Things change almost hour by hour, don't they? We don't know what the week holds for us, but fortunately, praise God, our faithful God does know what the week holds. Let's make sure that we continue to trust, follow, obey, love, and share our Savior, Jesus Christ, the man of sorrows. Along those lines, I want you to encourage or to invite folks to watch our worship service next weekend. Of course, this weekend as well, but next weekend, Easter weekend. Show them how they can get on the link to watch our worship service. So let's make sure this week we're following, trusting the Lord, not fearing. Let's make sure that he is not sorrowing over us this week. Amen. And amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this name, one of the many names of your Son Jesus, Man of Sorrows. And yet, Father, we know that he was not a morose person. He had joy in knowing what he was going to accomplish on the cross and the empty tomb. But he suffered greatly. He grieved greatly while he was on this earth. And now, Father, I believe that he's sorrowing even now over sinners who will not repent of their sin, who reject him and thus reject forgiveness of sins and eternal life. Oh, God, I beg you to work in people's hearts, draw them to put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. This may be one of the main messages of this whole coronavirus situation in our society, that you are shouting to us, you are screaming to us that you love us and you have a way for us to get to heaven. Oh, Father, may people repent of their sins and trust Jesus as their Savior. And Father, for those of us who have already done this, we've trusted in Christ. We know for sure that we're on our way to heaven. Lord, we know. We know without a shadow of a doubt we have sin in our lives. Father, I pray that you would cause us to fall on our knees before you, because I believe Jesus is sorrowing still over sin that we do not confess, sin that we do not take care of in our own lives, even as Christians. So, Father, we commit this week to you. We may be stunned and shocked by things that happened this week, even as we have been over the last couple of weeks. But Lord, we know that you're in control. You are sovereign. You have proven yourself to be faithful, and we have absolutely no reason whatsoever to doubt that you will be faithful to us this week. Father, I pray for anyone who is watching this service, who's having doubts and fears. Father, would you make yourself real and known to them by your word and by the Holy Spirit, that they do not need to fear, they do not need to have doubts. You are moving history along in the way that you see fit. You are moving this coronavirus situation along for as long as you want it to go. And we give you praise, Father. We give you thanks. We commit the week to you now. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, amen.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain.
Well, Grace Bible, we thank you again for tuning in and seeing us this week. We pray that you go out and share this hope, this joy, and just share the gospel with those who need it. Let's pray at this time. Righteous God, we do come to you. Jesus, we thank you that we don't have such a high priest that can't understand the things that we suffer with. That God, you do feel exactly what we have gone through, that you've struggled, but you've done it without sin. Let us take up that challenge, and let us have hope also that that could be us through your strength. I ask this week that you would keep us safe until next time. In your Son's righteous and holy name, amen.